I'm Tom Everhart. I live here in Venice, California. Fortunately survived colon liver cancer for 23 years now. And we're here in my studio talking about it. Contrary to what you're seeing in the subject matter of my work, I was never a fan of cartoons as a young child, but I always was drawn to coloring books. And I think it was the black empty lines that existed in the coloring books, much like Schulz's lines. Finding myself in some place like East Village in New York with other artists around 1980, late 70s, I think we all set out to make work that was to be approved by the art world, which completely dissatisfied me for years, but I stuck with it because I thought that's what you were supposed to do. That is exactly the time period that I met Charles Schulz as well. So I was being introduced to his way of seeing and his way of feeling. And this was something very different than what I had learned in university. In 1988, I was experiencing intense abdominal pains. And I was seeing a doctor for it. He was misdiagnosing me. The pains kept intensifying. I went to Johns Hopkins in Baltimore because I was recommended to go there. And they told me, they said, you have some kind of colon cancer. You're completely obstructed. We don't know how you're eating. It had also gone to the liver. And because it had traveled that far to the liver, it had gotten on the stomach, the gallbladder, and a few other important vital parts of your body. They said, we have basically one choice. We operate on you right now, tonight. I woke up basically from that 10-hour surgery to people whispering behind me that, you know, we're lucky if he makes it through the night. That was the story. So I stayed in the hospital for another month and a half. But during that point in the hospital, it was an interesting situation. I had on one side of me, I had a pile of art history books that my artist friends were bringing me to keep me company. And then Schulz kept sending me his strip. And in that period of time, somehow or another, it happened in my mind where I put the two together and came up with the body of work that you see today. Well, I had fallen in love. I had found this new passion because I was laying there in that bed just coming up with idea after idea after idea. And these images were just pouring out. I couldn't wait to get out of the hospital and get back to my studio. And every time I'd hear somebody talk about me dying, and it was just ridiculous. So when I got out of chemotherapy, they said, well, you'll have a maximum of 2 years to live. That's the average at Hopkins for someone to have what I have. So go out and have a wonderful life for 2 years. That statement that there had to be a much more important reason for making art besides being accepted by the art world was out the door. Didn't matter if the art world was going to hate me. It didn't matter if I was committing suicide. I had 2 years to do exactly what I wanted with my work without fear. I started doing the work right away. Showed it to Schulz. He loved it and said, we got to do something with this. You got to, because it looks like you're serious about it. Well, he said to me one time, he said, I feel like your work is a liberating faith against the restrictions and limitations that cartooning puts on a cartoonist. The lifestyle that I was living on the East Coast was completely unhealthy, although I didn't see it that way when I was living it, but it was. I was working all the time, painting all the time, partying all the time in between that. Now I, every day, go for an hour-long bike ride on the bike path. I wish I could push that on everybody. Take a break from everything you do, just a little bit, all the time. And that's the one thing I got definitely out of the hospital was, you have to understand that you're a life. And I would say that probably 99.9% of us don't understand or think about this. But I mean just the idea that you're a human being walking on this earth, breathing and eating and tasting and seeing. I mean, a lot of people you see walking around look like they're pissed off to be alive. And I don't want them to have to go in the hospital and almost die to understand that you're missing out. This is it, you know? Enjoy this stuff. So I take every single thing in these paintings from my day-to-day experiences. I'm never painting Snoopy, and that's something that's so misunderstood. And I'm never painting Pigpen or Charlie Brown when I'm painting them. They represent other people, and they represent other things sometimes. the year 2000, the death of Mr. Schulz shook me up like nothing had ever shook me up before. My wonderful girlfriend, wife Jennifer, did some research, and Tahiti sounded like it was the farthest thing away possible. So in 2000, we started going to Tahiti, and so a lot of the subject matter, the light treatment, the line treatment, the poses, the diving, the water things come from a big influence from Tahiti. As I said before, I fell in love while I was in my illness, and I didn't have time to think about being sick. And still today, when I go see the doctors, they go, "We don't know how you're living, but whatever you're doing, keep doing it." If you can find a way in your life to find something to see that just overwhelms you and shows you a new way of seeing, whether it's a relationship, a material object, a friend, whatever it is, if you can find a new way of seeing through something, hang on to it, because it can divert your vision from being ill.